everyone. My name is Eric Lehnen. I'm a marketing consultant and marketing lead here at Redpath Consulting Group. And this week we're going to be talking with Stan Sobocinski to talk about marketing strategy. Last week we talked about Salesforce Lightning, all the new changes that it brings, specifically with the new interface and all the new features, and some considerations to make. So if you want to go ahead and watch that video, go ahead and click on it through our YouTube channel, or you could download the audio version on iTunes or Stitcher. So Stan, why don't you do a little intro about yourself?
Sure. Hi, everyone. Yeah, I'm Stan Sobocinski. I'm an independent consultant and owner of a firm called Demandgenics. And I've been a partner with Eric over various marketing strategy and implementation projects.
Yeah, quite a few.
We have.
Fun ones, too. This week we're going to be talking about marketing strategy. And a lot of us as marketers know what marketing strategy is, and sometimes we don't. You know, it's, oh yeah, I'll build a marketing strategy to do that thing. But in your experience, how would you define a marketing strategy? What is it?
The essence of great strategy, Eric, is actually not fighting, but developing positions that others don't want to challenge. That's actually a quote from Sun Tzu, The Art of War.
Oh, good book.
And really to think about, not about the war part, but making people that they don't want to challenge you because you've got such a strong position.
Interesting. Okay, so dive a little bit deeper what that means for marketers.
Sure. In marketing, the primary strategies I think about for developing a strong position are segmenting, targeting, positioning, and branding. And you put those together, and that forms the basis for a great marketing strategy. And then underneath that becomes marketing communications, where you begin to communicate to and about your operation.
Okay, so you mentioned segmenting, targeting, positioning, and branding. So let's take those apart a little bit.
Sure.
What goes into them?
Okay, segmenting. Segmenting is really about deeply understanding and profiling your marketplace. And that is looking at things like demographics, something they call psychographics, and what we call firmographics. And demographics and firmographics, so demographics are about the individual, usually used in consumer B2C marketing.
Mm-hmm.
Firmographics are more in B2B marketing.
Got it. Okay, firmographics.
Right, and you're looking at the profile of the people or the organization, where they're located, how big they are, you know, what they do, typical kinds of variables and information that's often available about firms or about people.
Okay.
And psychographics, that's a little bit deeper into the goals and ambitions of the purchaser, the challenges, needs, and wants, the problems to be solved, and equally important, the fears and doubts and concerns they have. They're the dark side of purchase decisions.
Okay.
So understanding those things become important as you begin to think about who you're going to go after. First, you have to segment your market and understand it. Mm-hmm. That's segmentation.
Okay. So for a company like ours, because we have both small and large clients in between that do a large variety of this stuff. So what would be a good place to start if someone wanted to say, I want to do a better job of segmenting?
Sure. Well, so sounds like size is probably pretty important.
Mm-hmm.
So you'd create some size segments. You know, it might be small, medium, and large. It might be for-profit, non-profit, and small and medium within that, you know, something like that. Again, depending how you envision your business, the segments you're going to talk about are going to be different.
Mm-hmm.
That would be an example.
Okay.
On segmentation.
So almost building a matrix.
Yep.
Of them.
Okay. Yeah, that's how you can think about it, building a matrix. And then, you know, there's sort of everybody else, but the segmentation is really defining your broader market.
Yep.
And you won't play equally well in all parts of that market, which is what leads us to the next strategy of targeting.
Got it.
Right? So the targeting strategy, that's aimed at figuring out where are you going to get the biggest bang for your buck? We've all heard about the 80-20 rule. Well, targeting is the practical application of the 80-20 rule, putting 80% of your resources against the 20% of the market that's going to give you the biggest bang for the buck. Easy to say, hard to do.
Yeah.
Because you really got to understand your market.
Yep.
And one of the other secrets in targeting and segmenting and targeting is as you learn your market, you get insights about it that others can't appreciate. This is sort of part of, you know, developing a position where others can't attack you. Well, if you get insights that others don't have, you can target and segment in ways that others can't appreciate and can't do.
Yep, so it's all about developing that proprietary, here's how I'm fitting myself in the marketplace.
Right.
And obviously that's all going to be based on competitors and how they fit, but.
That's correct, that's correct. And the other part of targeting is you use that to develop something you call your ultimate buyer profile.
Mm-hmm.
Who's really your most significant buyer? Who do you really want to go after?
Mm-hmm.
There's different terms for it, but it's really kind of that idea, the profile of the buyer that really resonates with your value proposition, and really wants to work with you. And if you can get that profile developed through your targeting strategy, then you're on your way to applying the 80-20 rule.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Yeah, because from a targeting perspective, it's and positioning that I think is really the execution, or getting to that execution piece of here's how I'm going to be delivering my marketing to that.
Right.
And there's just so many other pieces that go into that puzzle, because you basically try to synthesize down from the whole matrix of segmenting and getting to these are the people I want to focus on, and make it actionable. This is why.
Yep.
And make it justifiable.
So much of marketing, we kind of forget, but is about who.
Mm-hmm.
Who are you really going after? Well, segmenting targeting is answering that question. Which then leads us to the next strategy, which is positioning.
Mm-hmm.
And positioning is really kind of about the what.
Yep.
Positioning appeals to the head. The aim of positioning is to occupy a place in the buyers in your target, in the minds, the buyers in your target market, relative to competing products and services. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So think of electric vehicles out there in the auto market, right? So Toyota came along with Prius, right?
Mm-hmm.
Electric vehicle appeal to the economy-minded folks. High gas mileage, it's a great car for people that wanted that. So what happened? Tesla came along, right? And they said, well, we want to get part of this market. But they decided, we're not going to go after the economy-minded. They still want economical.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to go after the high-end, the luxury sports car-minded person.
Mm-hmm.
And give them a car that, while it's got high economy, the reason they're buying is it's environmentally friendly,
yep.
Not because it's saving them money, because it's an expensive car,
yep.
Right? So beautiful job of positioning, Prius versus Tesla. Tesla came in and positioned themselves in the minds of the consumer in a different spot.
Yep, and now they're one of the most desirable car manufacturers out there.
Right. So your positioning strategy must create a basis for clearly communicating what
mm-hmm.
your business is about. And the most important parts of what is the category you're in. So in the case of the example I just gave you, electric vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
So the product category you're in, right? Your value proposition, you know, what's the value you're bringing? And then your differentiation. How are you really different? Those are probably the three most important parts
mm-hmm.
of positioning. And to go a little further, organizations will oftentimes develop a positioning statement articulating those things,
yep.
And have a lot of arguments inside the organization about what it really is.
Mm-hmm.
This is where trade-offs occur. And to the extent that you can get aligned as an organization around your positioning, it sets the basis for your subsequent communications, your MarCom,
yep.
work that's going to happen later.
And now, branding, bring it all together.
Right. Branding is also about not the what, but the who, the why, really the why,
mm-hmm.
right? Branding, unlike, so if positioning appeals to the head, branding appeals to our emotional center, the heart,
yep.
right?
A good way to put it.
yeah. And the aim of branding, because customers buy from brands they trust, the aim of branding is to really spark the emotional connections that drive purchase decisions.
Yep.
Research on decision making inevitably pinpoints the fact that decisions, we have lots of rational reasons for making decisions, things that we state to other people,
mm-hmm.
but it's the emotional reasons that in the end most often drive purchase decisions.
Mm.
So the aim of branding is to try to address that. So your branding, basically, your branding strategy, because people buy from brands they trust, the aim is to build trust.
Yep.
Build those emotional connections by clarifying who you are, what you stand for, and why you exist.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're talking, when you start talking about why you exist, we're really kind of talking about underlying values for an organization.
Almost turning that person or that the company into a person, personifying them.
That's right. That's right. Because again, if people buy from people they trust, you got to build trust. And building trust isn't something you turn on a meter and say, now I got trust. It happens step by step, day by day, little thing by little thing, to accumulate into big things, right? And so while folks oftentimes focus on your brand logo and your tagline and your colors as being what branding is all about, no. Branding is really about building trust, those emotional connections. Those things, the tagline, your logo, are the result of your understanding of how you're going to build trust, what values you have, and how you want to communicate that consistently in the marketplace.
Mm.
So while you talk to brand agencies and they'll get going on logos and things, always remember behind that is the values. And if you get the values articulated and get them clear, then you got a shot at doing the right thing with your logo and your tagline. More importantly, you got a shot at doing the right thing with your communications.
Yep. And I can also resonate with that, because us as a consulting firm for marketing and sales initiatives with Salesforce and Pardot and all the other platforms out there in between, it's really understanding why are we doing this.
Right.
There needs to be a purpose, and the implementation isn't always just configuring, coding, and setting it up. It's developing that process of why. Why does it work that way?
So do a good job with branding. You basically have to have the basis for clearly communicating why you exist,
mm-hmm.
why you're doing things. Really, your values have to come through in all those communications. And an important part of trust is consistency.
Yep.
So your brand can't be one thing one day and something else the next day. You have to have it figured out so it's consistent, because that's part of trust. If you're dancing around, you know, 15 different things, I'm not going to trust you.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe you. Right? And you can think about all kinds of examples about this. An interesting company that I think did a particularly good job was Airbnb.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, think about it for a moment. Really? I'm going to make my house available to somebody I don't know from another country or from the standpoint of the buyer.
Mm-hmm.
Really? I'm going to go into a house of somebody I don't know in a place I don't know. And I mean, how's the trust there?
Yeah.
And yet Airbnb, you know, articulated their values very clearly, decided they were appealing to, you know, someone that's conscious about their dollar, but they also want a good experience. They want to experience the culture, adventure,
mm-hmm.
to kind of get at that. But they also did a great job of looking at the trust factors. So making it easy for you to look at ratings, easier for you to communicate not just with the owner of the establishment, but prior customers,
mm-hmm.
right? They got a guarantee for the proprietor. I think it's $1 million guarantee that something happens.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing a lot of things to build trust, right? So they took a concept that, like, on its surface is untrustworthy,
yeah.
and made it higher, much higher trust.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was a very large operation. Branding is about trust, and those values are really the way you do that. And then once you've articulated that, you start to embed that in all of your communications. And now we can start talking about, well, how do we communicate, right? But you
yep.
have to have that basis. That's strategy. It's looking at those things, developing your thought process about that. And you never get it all perfect right
mm-hmm.
at once, but you have a basis for it and you constantly evolve it.
Yep.
Your market evolves too, so sometimes you will make changes in your targeting, your segmenting, your positioning.
Mm-hmm.
Branding changes not so often. You may have to make changes, but very carefully. You hear people talk about rebranding.
Yep.
It's a big decision.
Yep.
You really got to get it right.
So around developing a strategy, let's talk a little bit more about some of the pitfalls and things you need to watch out for, and then also the best practices. So what are the things that someone that already has a strategy in place or looking to revise it or almost do a whole revitalization of it or creating a brand new one?
I would say the first thing, Eric, is the failure of leadership in activating a strategy is the first pitfall. And by activating, I mean, if you have inadequate resources for what you're trying to do, you got a mismatch. So maybe you got to scale back your
mm-hmm.
targeting
yeah.
to not have such a big mismatch, right?
And that's a big thing to talk about, too, is, you know, we need to go after these people because I need to market to everyone and give my company the best chance it has to market. But oftentimes that's very easily wastable marketing dollars, is
right.
you're hoping that extra 10% will give you an additional revenue stream, but it's likely that ROI is mismatched.
Yep, exactly. I mean, targeting is prioritizing segments. You can have, I think of it as like owning a hill in a battle, right? There's lots of hills to own. Which hill are you going to own? And from that hill, where do you go forth to conquer other hills?
Yep.
Same thing with targeting strategy, right? Which target segment are we going to get first? Capture mm-hmm. that first, you know, have a strong, sound base, and then go after segments 2, 3, and 4. You can own the market. It's just going to take time. That's
and I think
strategy.
That is the key, is many marketers and sales and leadership
That's
are
right.
all impatient.
So inadequate resource, not aligning them with your strategy, is an important one. A toxic culture is another one.
Mm-hmm.
Back to the values thing. If you have a toxic culture, you're not going to come across consistent in your values. Because you have some great people, and you're going to have some toxic people. That's going to be a problem, right? Dysfunctional teams kind of comes from a toxic culture.
Mm-hmm.
But those things are leadership issues. And if you don't have good leadership, this other stuff isn't going to work very good.
Yep.
So that's an important one. Another pitfall, you know, underneath that is I'd call it lack of strategic focus. And that's where if you're focused on 10 segments instead of one or two priorities, right?
Yep.
You start to confuse the market because you put out a message for this segment, then one for that one, and then for this one, and you confuse the market, right?
That's a good point, because you may not always control where the message is read or absorbed.
Absolutely. You know, and that brings with it sort of dilution of resources, because
mm-hmm.
they get diluted, and you get minimal impact, right? So that lack of focus causes you the problem. And lastly, oftentimes the lack of focus is maybe not the cause of, but an indicator of another problem, which is a business model that's not sustainable or not scalable.
Mm.
So, you know, those things have to work together, or your lack of focus is going to be an issue.
Yep, makes sense.
So, leadership, focus. The next one would be disciplined execution, right? You got a good strategy, you got your plans in place, now how do you execute? Do you do that with discipline? And for us, being marketing people and salespeople, it's the alignment oftentimes of marketing and sales that determines disciplined execution or not.
Yep.
And almost every organization I've been in will say they have a problem in this area and will say they've tried to address the problem. And it's an ongoing challenge. I would just say that's it. It's an ongoing challenge. You need to be aware of it, go with your eyes open, and constantly drive for greater and greater alignment.
Yep.
This is one place where tools like the ones that your organization offers or other tools that are out there help, because they cause a conversation to occur between marketing and sales.
And it creates accountability on both sides.
Great. And accountability is key to making that work. So
mm-hmm.
getting that alignment and getting accountability. The other part of lack of discipline is if you don't have good metrics, lack of discipline, no good metrics, you don't know where you're going,
yep.
you know, if you got there or not. Most importantly, probably, you don't really have data for improving.
Mm.
So lack of market metrics, but also lack of data for continual improvement. So we need our systems to help us generate data about the tactics we're executing on so we can learn and improve.
Yep. And I also add, you need leadership or a strategic focus on what data to be pulling, because I think a lot of these pitfalls are interrelated. You may
Correct.
Have all the data in the world, but unless you know someone that really understands what data you're searching for, you're basically looking at a needle in a haystack.
That's exactly right. The fourth one, I would say, kind of leads back to the branding, which is lack of trust in the firm's value proposition. So if you're inconsistent, right? If you make a promise here and don't deliver there, that's inconsistent. If you say one thing one day about what your brand is and then something quite different the next day about what it is, that's inconsistent,
mm-hmm.
right? If the values aren't aligned, right? You got two values, but they sort of fight with each
mm-hmm.
other, that's a problem, right? Then I would also say if they don't trust the expertise you have, so you say you're great at something, but kind of shallow.
Yeah.
You know, it comes across,
yep.
right? So that lack of trust. And then lastly, you know, usually, and that's particularly true if you're in a service business, you need some sort of I call it transformative process, a way that you're going to help a client go from point A to point B by transforming how they did something. Whatever
yep.
your service does helps do that, right? In theory, products help make changes too, depending what the product is
yep.
is for. And then lastly, of course, results. You know, out of all this, we got to see indications of results. So if that doesn't exist, you know, a little alarm bell goes off, potential buyer. I'm not sure I can trust these folks.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not going to take a chance on them.
Yep.
Everybody's, when you buy, you're kind of taking a chance.
Mm-hmm.
And really, that's part of good branding. When somebody is in a vulnerable moment where they're considering a purchase decision or making a purchase decision, to the extent the organization can help them through their vulnerable moments, reassure them, hold their hand, guide mm-hmm. them, that wins a lot of points in terms of brand trust and trusting that organization to take on even bigger things.
Yep. And that, I think it's worth saying without really mentioning too much in detail, but first impressions go a long way with that.
Absolutely. That's why you have to get it right the first time. Right.
Yep. That's why it's a lot of work to win those clients.
Right,
because, you know,
right. So failure of leadership, lack of strategic focus, lack of discipline, and then lack of trust in the value proposition, to me, are the biggest pitfalls that we see out there.
I would agree. So let's end it with some of the best practices. What are the things that you see as these are things that you need to hit to be successful?
Well, I'll go back to the first thing I started talking about, which is target customers. Again, the 80-20 rule, we hear it everywhere. And if you don't get that figured out, you don't have a prayer, I think, especially in today's market.
Yep.
Right. So targeting customers is an absolute best practice. You got to do it. You got to get it right. Another one that I think about is buyer personas. You know, more and more these days, your brand message is carried on the web.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where people go to learn about you, to figure out if they can trust you, to get more information, to reinforce that they should trust you. They're going to the web, right?
Yep.
I mean, you can get some stuff to them, but it's onesie-twosie. It's the web where they're going.
Mm-hmm.
And it isn't just your website. It's all those other websites that you're connected with, right? And so buyer personas are thinking about, this is especially true in business to business, where there isn't usually just one influence on a purchase decision.
Yep.
Right? I mean, oftentimes you've got, I'll call it the executive buyer. It's the person who nods their head yes. They may not actually write the check, but they nod their head yes,
mm-hmm.
right? There's the operational leader, the person who's responsible for the results of the investment
yeah.
they're going to make, whose, you know, bonus is on the line, whose performance review is on the line if they don't get it right,
mm-hmm.
right? And then there's the implementers, the users, the people that are in using your product or service to actually do the work,
yep.
right? And each of those three people have brand promises being made to them that the company has to deliver on.
Yep.
So if you think, as a minimum, if you think of those three as personas, how do you speak to them?
Mm-hmm. And they're all going to be different.
How does your website speak to them? Do you have different places, different approaches? You know, how do your communications speak to them? I mean, you have to think about that. So buyer personas, I think in today's world, are really important as a consideration as we think about our marketing communications and what we do.
Yep.
The third one is, and kind of related to that, I call it a marketing communications platform, which is the articulation of your positioning strategy and your branding strategy. So it's putting down, having those debates in-house about, well, what are our values? You know, what is our value proposition? What are our differentiators?
Yep.
You know, and you don't have to have the world's best differentiator. You just got to have a good differentiator that you can shine a light on
mm-hmm.
and make it sound like it's the best.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, and those people that really care about that, then they're going to resonate to it. So MarCom platforms, to me, is an important part of capturing that part of strategy. And then I'd say the last one is something I call lead life cycles. Lead life cycles are a way to think about the journey that a potential buyer is on, right? People start out not knowing about your company. I mean, forget for a moment the people, your current customers, you're trying to get new customers. They don't know your company, they don't know what you do, they don't know why they should even care about your company. And in today's business world, the less they have to think about you, the better,
yep.
right? So we have to take people from that spot to becoming aware of your company, becoming interested in your company, considering your company, buying from your company, right? And so that's what a lead life cycle is about. And there, the way I think about that is maybe you've heard the term content marketing.
Mm-hmm.
And these days, content is a big way of building trust. you develop content on your website and you communicate with it to help build trust with people that you know what you're talking about.
Yep.
And I kind of think of three kinds of content to help in that journey. So for the people that aren't thinking about your company or unaware of you, I call it blissfully ignorant of you, right? You got to have something that breaks the status quo with them, gets them to go from blissfully ignorant to, maybe I ought to check this out. And the way to think about that, these are people, the people you're trying to appeal to at very early are people that are in decision-making roles,
mm-hmm.
They have responsibilities in organizations, and they care about their job and about staying employed and beating their competition because that's what they're paid to do,
yep.
Right? And so anything that you can speak to that talks to trends, talk to changes in the environment knowledgeably, or bring information from others that's knowledgeable about things that are relevant to your industry that they might be interested in, that helps to break status quo and get them to go from blissfully unaware to, this company had some interesting content that they provided
mm-hmm.
me. A little tick in the trust corner.
Yep.
Not a very big tick, but
they recognize it now.
You add ticks together to get big.
Yep.
Right? So you start to recognize it. Exactly right. So you go from breaking the status quo to the next level, which is, excuse me, feeling the pain. So here, the pain is usually for executives and people in decision-making and operational leadership roles is either hitting top-line numbers, improving bottom-line performance, or mitigating risk. It could be risk, talent risk. It could be regulatory risk. It could be competitive risk, right? People have responsibilities in those areas, and to the extent you can begin to make them aware of how the kinds of product and services you offer, not necessarily your company,
yep.
but the category, helps them with top-line performance, growth, bottom-line performance, or mitigating risk, again, gets them to sit up and take notice.
Mm-hmm.
And then lastly is what I call solution search. People sit up and take notice, and they're starting to think, maybe I do have to do something about this. You want to be relevant to them in that solution search.
Yep.
And here's where, you know, your case stories, your guides for making decisions, all kinds of other information about implementing new approaches can help people build trust, understand your approach, and get further down that purchase decision cycle.
Yep.
So that's the lead life cycle. I've been a little long there, but I think it's really important to think about that for your content. Because that you're now going to go to how do we communicate, and having those things in your arsenal will help you with your communications.
Yep. So identifying the lead, customer lifecycle really, and then identifying what are those milestones you're hitting along the way, and what I think you mentioned that case studies is really good for the people that are really trying to find that solution.
Right.
So aligning the right people with the right content along that journey.
Right.
And each stage of the buying
that's
cycle.
Exactly right.
So that's all we have for this week. We thank you for tuning in, and we'll catch you next time. Thank you, Stan, for coming along.
You're welcome. Thank you.